I'm Brook Lee, and this is Modern Wahine Hawaii. Welcome to Modern Wahine Hawaii. I'm here at the historic Kumu Kahua Theatre with Donna Blanchard, who is the managing director. Hi, Donna.
Hi.
So we're socially distanced. Let's go ahead and take our masks off. Let's talk about 50 years of Kumu Kahua.
It's really exciting, isn't it? 50 years of plays by and about people here in
Hawaii. Congratulations. So how did you get involved with Kumu Kahua?
You know, I was in the Chicago market. I've been involved in theater for all of my adult life as an actor and director, and then eventually managing director of another theater. And I fell in love with this concept of theater of place, theater devoted to the people within its geographic footprint. And I started looking for a theater like that. That's where I wanted to put my energy. And this is the only one I found. In the country.
Really?
Yes.
Wow.
Solely devoted to entire seasons of theater by and about the people here.
Right. And so you packed your stuff up and came out this way, or?
Well, I did. It just so happened that Kumu Kahua at the same time was looking for a managing director who had experience. So we were sort of a match made in heaven that found each other. And yeah, I had never been here before, and I packed my bags and came.
That's our lucky break on our side. So you mentioned theater of sense of place. What does that exactly mean? Like for people, you know, in Hawaii who are in the theater community, what is Kumu Kahua's sort of fingerprint in that sense?
So this organization was started by a group of graduate students at University of Hawaii at Manoa, who they were playwriting students and they wanted a place to put their plays on a stage. And what they recognized in giving themselves that voice, that platform, is that people who were not represented in traditional media, suddenly they found a way to represent themselves, their
right.
families. And you know, when you see yourself reflected on a stage or a screen, it imbues your sense of identity with a reality and helps cultivate a sense of immediacy and presence in your own life.
Mm-hmm.
Because you realize it does matter. Your story does matter every bit as much as those others that you see, not necessarily the homogenized Caucasian Euro vision.
Right. And so I guess a little bit of props out to UH with their playwright, programs to encourage, you know, those individual voices to not shy away from that and go for a bigger macro picture, but to really drill down and get to know who you are and what the voices are in the community and then come to Kumu Kahua and find a home. So that's amazing. So let's talk about what's going to be happening now with arts, because it's just been so hard for the arts community in general to be able to do what they love, express themselves, because we can't reconvene together communally and watch a theater performance live. So what have you guys had to do in order to make it through this time period?
We pivoted, there's the word. We almost immediately, when we shut down in March 14th of 2020, and we were supposed to open a show, I think, on the 18th.
Wow.
And we knew that we wanted to continue to serve our mission during that time. So we started engaging our artists and put together programming that was really just going out via email and social media.
Got it.
And we had a really great response to
good.
It. About a year ago, we did a storyteller's night. And we had that in Zoom, and you can get 100 people in there, and it filled up.
Oh, wow.
As soon as we opened the doors, it filled up, and we had to live stream to Facebook for the overflow. So many people were interested. So that really gave us the confidence to move forward and decide that, okay, we can't be in person now, but we can still serve our mission.
Right.
So over the summer, we did a project in response to Black Lives Matter and George Floyd and Breonna Taylor. And more than 10,000 people watched.
Wow.
And we were on the verge of opening our 50th season.
Right.
Yeah. Very important, and we didn't want to skip it. So we are just about to wrap up our 50th season, every single one of those shows online.
Wow. That's unprecedented.
It really is. They've all been performed live. Mm-hmm. We've had some additions of work with film within the pieces,
right.
But they have all been performed live, and they're streamed using technological
wizardry.
Magic, as
yeah.
far as I know.
Yeah.
Yes, it's all happening. We're getting it to people, and we also shifted our pricing to pay what you can. We're happy to accept donations,
right.
And if someone cannot donate, then that's okay too.
Wow.
But we've had people in 36 states and 8 countries, and I think much more importantly, all over Hawaii.
Right.
People on Molokai and Lanai are watching our shows, and they weren't able to come here in person to see our shows. They've been able to watch our shows online.
So I guess that's sort of the sunny side of the street, is that, you know, you can only fit so many people in a room, and some can't come from the outer island. This is the opportunity to open up to different markets that you necessarily couldn't get when people were coming down to the theater. So that's, I guess, the upside to that. But nothing beats live theater, for sure.
Oh, yeah. And we're going to go back live as soon as we can. Clearly, we have a small theater.
Right.
So we're probably going to be one of the last that's going to be able to go live again.
Right.
But once we do go live, we're committed to maintaining a digital aspect to our work as well.
Right.
So that those people in the 36 states and 8 countries and all over the archipelago are going to be able to watch us still.
Well, thank you so much for being on the show today. I really appreciate you taking the time, and happy birthday to Kumu Kahua.
Thank you so much for being here.
Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Modern Wahine Hawaii. We're back here at Kumu Kahua, and I'm here with Tari Kinoshita, who's a director here at Kumu Kahua. Hi.
Hello.
Let's take our masks off. How are you?
Great, Brooke. Thank you. How are you?
I'm good. Welcome back to your environment. I know you guys haven't been really able to get down into the nitty-gritty here. But I wanted to talk to you about, how did you get involved with Kumu Kahua?
I had a messed up childhood, very messed up. I was homeless, actually, when I first started acting my first Kumu Kahua play when I was like a little kid. And so I was acting here, and then I started doing more theater. And theater, as we all know, is the best discipline in the world.
Yes.
It gives you all the confidence, adaptability, discipline as sports, but you also get reading comprehension, memorization, vocabulary, new perspectives. And so it kind of really just saved my life, as
it were. And a little bit of therapy, if you want to talk about it.
It is. It really is. It really is. You walk out confident, with the ability to get along with other people. It's a social art form. So I started majoring in theater, and I was very lucky because at UH I had a wonderful teacher named Dr. Dennis Carroll, who just was a mentor to everybody. He was a great role model. He took an interest in all the students, and he was one of the founders of Kumu Kahua Theater. I have thanked him in every single program, for every single show I've ever directed, and I will continue to do so for the rest of my life, because he is that great of a person. He got me involved more in Kumu Kahua, and I had a friend named R. Kevin Doyle, who suggested I start directing. I had a long streak where I didn't get cast in anything. So R. Kevin suggested I tried directing, and I did, and he taught me a great deal about directing. And then as a young director, Harry Wong, who's the current artistic director, was a huge guiding light for me in terms of learning about theater and what makes theater great and powerful. And I was able to do shows here at Kumu Kahua on their dark nights. They'd have these dark nights where you could kind of self-produce these shows,
right.
And young directors could get experience. So from the beginning, really, Kumu Kahua has been an incredible influence on my life.
And so as a director, you know, giving back to this art form that has done so much for you, how do you approach it when you see, I'm assuming you see a little bit of yourself in some of the people that come through here. How do you approach all of that?
As Donna mentioned, it really, really is such an integral theater. It's such an important theater. It's the only theater in the world that does plays by, for, and about the people of Hawaii. By, for, and about the people of Hawaii. And that's so crucial, not just because we all need to hear different stories and see different perspectives, but for just the experience we have in our daily lives, right? Like if you are only seeing a white male president or a white male authority figure in media, in cinema, in film, in theater, then that is your image of who is commanding, who you're supposed to listen to. So, you know, people who aren't that walk into a room and we have to work so much harder.
Right.
And so we need to see all the different people and all the different roles so that, you know, we can sort of get that out of our system, that conditioning of who looks like what and what looks like this and who is like this because they look like this. It's all ridiculous. Mm-hmm. And then so yeah, the notion that there is this company, Kumu Kahua, that does plays by, for, and about the people of Hawaii. There'll be an Okinawan play, a Japanese play, a Hawaiian play, a just generally local play. I mean, all in one season, really encouraging local playwrights is just incredible. And they take chances. They are not afraid to choose a play that people might not understand.
Right.
And that's so important to see an artwork and think, I don't like it, but wait, what are the choices being made? What is it saying? And every time you have to think deeper about something and disregard your own personal subjective feelings, you're becoming a better person.
Right.
So I love that, like Kumu, the first show I did with Susan Soonhi Stanton was a play called The Underneath, and it's an expressionist play. And so you might watch it and not quite get it the first time, but like any great work of art, if you give it some thought, there'll be more to it. And so Kumu takes chances on works like that. They keep the ticket prices low for people. That's so beautiful. It's an important theater that I have been working with for quite some time, from the time I was this high.
I mean, that's amazing that you grew up in the program. I'm wondering for you as a director, having grown up and being on both sides, so what do you look for when you're directing now? Like, what has switched for you? When you come here and you approach a project, like, what are you trying to get to?
I've always been interested in plays that enlighten people in some way, or some are political in some way, possibly just because they're gonna open your eyes or educate you. Though recently, in the last, I wanna say 7 years since we moved back from England, I am particularly interested in plays that have roles for some of my Windward Community College students, frankly, because it's really important for me to give opportunities to the incoming generation, just like I had. But political, educational, theater that enlightens an audience in some way, that's always sort of, that's just kind of stayed the same, I think, throughout my whole career, as it were, yeah.
Well, this is what I love about this whole situation, especially with you, is you were practically raised by this theater in the artist community, and you went from one side of the stage to the other side of the stage, and it's a full circle for a 50th year for Kumu Kahua, and you're an embodiment of the whole progression of unique voices, unique opportunities, and then the giving back at the end. So thank you so much for being a part of my show and for sharing your story with everyone, because this, you are Kumu Kahua embodied head to toe.
Thank you, Brooke.
Thank you for coming on the show today.
Oh, thank you, and thank you for your show. I just wanted to say that I've been watching it, and it's wonderful, and just thank you for doing what you do and highlighting the people of Hawaii.
I'm just following in the footsteps of Kumu Kahua, so thanks for coming on the show.
Thank you, Brooke.
Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
Hi, welcome back to Modern Wahine Hawaii. Brooke was invited to judge the Miss Universe pageant in Florida, so I'm stepping in to help share Susan's story. This is Susan Soonhi Stanton. She's one of our playwrights at Kumu Kahua Theater. Hi, Susan. Thank you for being here.
Hi, aloha. Thank you.
Susan is on set on the East Coast with HBO's Succession. I'm especially grateful that you've taken this time out to talk with us. So you've been a writer for Kumu Kahua Theater
pretty much all your life. Would you tell us a little bit about why you still take time to write for this little theater while you're making a big name for yourself in New York?
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, writing Hawaii specific stories is really important to me. I think this is one of the most unique places in the world and has just a really rich and vibrant history that needs to be told. But yeah, I did, the first reading of a play I ever had was at Kumu Kahua, which is what I sent as my writing portfolio when I went to college at NYU, and then I just kind of stayed. And then my first production was at Kumu Kahua. So for me, I think of Kumu as just a real artistic home and a place that I'm honored to do work at. So for me, it's not small, and it's one of the, I think, primary and few theaters in Hawaii that really puts a focus on new work and the voices of playwrights, not just doing theater in Hawaii, but telling Hawaii stories. And so for me, that's really sacrosanct and so important to just support and also collaborate with.
That's awesome. And we are coming up to one of your shows at Kumu Kahua Theater now. And I think we've done one of your shows at least every other year for a while now. This one is about the TMT project. Would you talk a little bit about how you came to that script and your experience with it?
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's called Untitled TMT Project because I think it is such a large, all-encompassing story that's so complicated, I think, for everyone and keeps changing. And so I think it's something that I've been tracking for a number of years, and it's really ensemble-y built. It's based on time going to Hawaii Island and doing interviews, going to town hall meetings. And so it's a fictional play, but it's kind of a hybrid of a documentary style. Like Laramie Project might be a good example of it, where it's about bringing a space where a lot of different points of view, a lot of truths can be heard, hopefully a space where, you know, I went to the telescopes and interviewed scientists. I interviewed a number of different activists. I interviewed Harry Kim, you know, so I ended up with kind of just like a wide swath of trying to talk to as many people who would be willing to talk to me and tried to present, you know, it's sort of like an orchestra of a play. It's quite an undertaking, and I'm so grateful for our amazing, you know, Harry Wong, the director, and our cast and our crew.
I'm really looking forward to it. It's going to be a cool piece of the season for our 50th season for us. So, Susan, can I put you on the spot just a little bit? I'm really anxious to know, if you had to choose between screenwriting and playwriting, which one would you choose?
theater is always where I started. I think it's where the heart is. I think as a playwright, all of your words are the most protected. But you know, the fun thing about doing film is, I mean, you get to work with these people who are like, oh my gosh, they're like so famous, and also, you know, you reach a much wider audience. And so for me, I think I'm lucky in that I can toggle between, and they're very different forms, so I'm lucky that I don't have to choose. But I think my heart and my beginnings are always in theater.
I was hoping you would say that. I'm really glad that you get to do both, and I'm looking forward to the next season of Succession, of course. If you were going to tell someone about Kumu Kahua Theater who had never heard of it before, how would you describe our beloved theater?
So, I mean, I think of Kumu as a really unique place that has an extremely important and vital role, but I also think it's not like it's so serious. I mean, I think you guys do. I mean, you know, like that's where like Lee Catalina's Demare first came to light. And so, I mean, it's a place where a lot of different stories, like light and dark, funny, historical, very present, can be told. So, and it's also like in the post office. Like, for me, it's like just right in downtown, and it's just a lovely place to just go and see, you know, really original new work from all these writers that I admire greatly.
Cool. And, you know, I love that we're producing digitally now, too. So hopefully you'll be able to be with us for the premiere of your show. Even if you're not, you're still going to be able to watch it in New York. And that's cool, too. What's next on the horizon for you?
I've been working on some different shows as well. I'm working on something, the follow-up to Normal People with BBC and Hulu. I did a Modern Love episode that's coming out with Amazon, and doing some theater too. I'm just kind of like researching a new show. So yeah, it's kind of that hybrid, the freelancer's matrix of work.
I just love that you're stretching yourself in all different directions. I feel like that's part of the key to your success, is that you jump in with both feet and try so many different things. What advice would you give to a writer here in Hawaii who's just starting out?
I think just like trust yourself and trust your original voice and your storytelling. I think when I was growing up, I sort of felt like, oh, I need to write like other people, or that this is the right way to do something, or, you know, I needed the sort of gold star or the accolade of like something in LA or in New York. And I think it's about, you know, mastering your craft and becoming good. Like, you shouldn't be so arrogant that you don't try to be better. But I think it's also just realizing that, you know, the stories in Hawaii matter and need to be told and need you to tell it. Writing's a lot of work. It's lonely at times, and there's no fast solution. Like, you can't hide behind bad writing. Just keep plugging away at it. And then it's so fun to collaborate with people when it finally all comes to life.
Awesome. Thank you so much for the conversation and for taking this time out. Susan Sunhi Stanton.
Thank you so much for having me, Donna and Modern Wahine.
Always nice to see you. Don't go anywhere. Modern Wahine Hawaii is going to be right back.
Well, that's our show for today, Hawaii. Happy birthday to Kumu Kahua, 50 years going strong with individual voices here in Hawaii. Thank you to Donna Blanchard, who is the managing director here, for holding it down for Kumu Kahua and helping them to turn things around and keeping things going, especially during this pandemic. It's a pivotal time, as she likes to say, and it's very important to keep going with the arts. To Tari Kinoshita, who is, you know, such a unique voice and such a wonderful story to see that she was raised through Kumu Kahua, turned around, became a director, is now giving back to her students, especially on the Windward side. So mahalo to her for sharing her unique vision. And Susan Stanton, who zoomed in to share all of her wonderful stories about being with Kumu Kahua and going beyond. So mahalo to her. Remember, we gotta wash our hands, wear those masks, socially distance when we can, so one day we can all be back here in the theater celebrating 50 more years of Kumu Kahua. If you wanna check them out, go to kumukahua.org to support. And I'll see all of you next week.